Hey there, Bea here, and welcome back to Integrated Physics and Chemistry. We've been learning about Newton's laws of motion, and today we're ready to tackle the last one, his third law of motion. Have you ever seen a rocket launch? You may have wondered how in the world it's possible to lift over 1 million pounds of metal into the air at speeds in the thousands of miles per hour. It seems like it should be impossible. Fortunately, it's not, due to Newton's third law of motion. But before we launch into this lesson, let's look at our goals. By the end, you'll be able to explain Newton's third law of motion, identify action-reaction pairs, and explain how rockets are able to travel in space. Just like Newton's first two laws, his third law deals with the idea of forces and how they affect the motion of an object. It states that for every force, there is an equal and opposite force. Or we could say that two touching objects will apply a force to each other, and those forces will be equal in magnitude but have opposite directions. In this case, a person pushes on the wall, and as a result, the wall pushes back on the person. Let's imagine that the person pushes with a force of 10 newtons. How much force does the wall have to push back with? 10 newtons. Otherwise, the person would go crashing right through the wall. This is why Newton's third law says that the forces involved are both equal and opposite. They are equal in magnitude, meaning both forces, in this example, have a magnitude of 10 newtons, but they were in opposite directions. Let's think about another example that involves motion. Have you ever hammered a nail into a piece of wood? If so, you know that every time the hammer puts a force on the nail, it gets driven a little deeper into the wood. How does Newton's third law explain this? Whatever force the hammer puts on the nail puts right back on the hammer. So why then does the nail move down instead of pushing the hammer up? It's because of mass. Just because the forces are equal doesn't mean the response will be equal. A large hammer putting a force of 10 newtons on a tiny nail will have a big effect on the nail, driving it deeper into the wood. The 10 newtons of force that gets put back on the hammer will barely be noticeable because of the hammer's mass. This same idea explains why jumping on a trampoline results in you falling back down to the earth, instead of the earth falling up to you. If you have a weight of 100 pounds, that's approximately 440 newtons. So the Earth puts a force of 440 newtons on you, which causes you to fall downward at a rate of 9.8 meters per second squared. You also put a force of 440 newtons on the Earth. But good luck noticing any acceleration at all of the Earth toward you, because it is so much more massive. That force of 440 newtons is minuscule in relation to a planet. Remember Newton's second law of motion, which states that force equals mass times acceleration? This helps us see why equal forces do not mean equal responses. If the same force acts on two objects of different mass, they will experience different accelerations. The more massive object will have less acceleration, and the less massive object will have more acceleration. This is because mass and acceleration are inversely proportional. For one to go up, the other must go down. Newton's third law tells us that forces come in pairs. Every object that exerts a force gets that same amount of force back. The force initially exerted is typically called the action force, and the force that is exerted in return is called the reaction force. Let's see if you can identify the reaction force that would result from an action force with a few examples. We'll start with an easy one. If a book sits on a table, the action force is the downward force of the book on the table due to gravity. What is the reaction force? It's the exact opposite. So the reaction force is the upward force that the table exerts on the book. We don't know how many newtons of force exist here without knowing the weight of the book, but we know that the upward and downward forces must be equal in magnitude. One hint to keep in mind when finding action-reaction force pairs is that the two forces will act on different objects. In the last example, if one force acts on the table, the other force must act on something else. In this case, the book. This is why action and reaction force pairs can never cancel each other out. They act on different objects. Let's try some more examples. Have you ever stepped out of a small boat and watched it move backward away from you as you reach the dock? This is a perfect example of Newton's third law of motion. To step out of the boat, what do? You probably push backward on the boat with your foot. This is the action force. What is the reaction force? The boat pushes you forward, which results in you being able to step onto the dock. Notice that there was a force in each direction, one force on the boat, the other on the person. The magnitudes of these forces would have been equal. As a result of these forces, which object moves more? In cases involving a small boat, such as a canoe, the boat moves more. If you have more mass than the boat, you may only move forward a foot or so, just enough to get onto the dock. But the boat may accelerate backward several feet because its smaller mass responds more dramatically to the same force. Okay, one more example. What about a cannon firing? The action force is the forward force on the cannonball from the cannon. If you watch carefully, you can see the reaction force. What is it? Backward force on the cannon itself from the cannonball. The cannon even moves backward a small amount, though it doesn't accelerate at nearly the same rate as the cannonball because it is so much more massive. An important thing to remember about action and reaction forces is that they sometimes cause motion, sometimes not. It depends on what other forces are acting on an object and how much mass the object has. Sometimes the action force may cause an object to move, but the reaction force does not cause the other object to move, or the other way around. In fact, it actually doesn't matter which force we call the action force and which we call the reaction force. We simply know that they will always come in pairs, and that their magnitudes will be equal, while their directions are opposite. You've practiced identifying some action and reaction forces. Now I've got a more challenging one for you. Can you identify the action and reaction forces at work when a rocket launches? They may seem a little less obvious than in our previous examples. After the launch engines ignite, they produce hot exhaust gases out the back of the rocket. This is the action force, the downward force of the rocket on these gases. Can you guess the reaction force? It is the resulting upward force of the gases on the rocket. This is called the thrust and is what pushes the rocket up and off the ground. Before the first successful rockets were launched into space, many people believed that space travel would be impossible because in space there is no air for the rocket exhaust to push against. Luckily, Newton's third law of motion does not require any. It's not the exhaust pushing against the air that provides thrust. It's the exhaust pushing back against the rocket itself. So that's one hurdle we don't have to worry about when trying to explore the solar system. The lack of atmosphere in space is actually helpful to spacecraft because it means they don't encounter any friction from air resistance, meaning that they can produce less force or burn less fuel and achieve the same acceleration. This is one reason that NASA has suggested using the moon as a launching station to send spacecraft to Mars. Between the lack of atmosphere and lower gravitational force, far less fuel would have to be burned to launch a rocket from the moon. But, of course, we have to get all of the materials to the moon first, which is no small task. Newton's third law seems to favor this approach, though. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how Newton's third law of motion can be used to identify the action and reaction force pairs at work in the universe. No object can exert a force without having a force exerted right back. This reaction can sometimes be used to generate motion, like in the case of a rocket launching to space. And speaking of launching, next time we'll look at what happens when we launch objects right here on Earth in a lesson on projectile motion. Until then, remember, the universe is vast and full of surprises, so never stop exploring. I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.